So the composition of the Earth's early atmosphere, constantly bombarded by all this lightning, can generate soup. Okay, fine, but that's just a mishmash. And how are we going to go from the sort of building blocks, the little bits and pieces of life, to these long chains of RNA, DNA, and protein? Well, it turns out a very likely candidate for lengthening these long chains of organic material comes from clay crystals. Clay crystals, if you kind of play in the mud and you kind of wish it around, that's clay, okay? And it's kind of smooth, it's slippery. And the reason it's so slippery is that they're little tiny microscopic sheets, okay? And so they slide back and forth. Now, on the surface of one of those little clay crystals in the clay, each point has a slightly different electrical charge, okay? So if we have a surface that has a lot of variability on a very tiny scale in electrical charges, that may have provided the necessary template for the first nucleotide chains. So here we have a hypothetical version of the surface of a clay crystal, and some areas are positively charged, some are negatively charged, and that charge varies. And so we may have a situation there where just these raw soup of nucleotides would have been attracted by these slight differences in electrical charge. So here the C goes on next to the U, the G, C coming down. They're just randomly attaching. Well, not randomly, because they're each attracted to a particular charge of the surface of the clay crystal. And so these would be coming along, sometimes close to each other, and sometimes so close together with the clay was hot that they would be bonded together in a chain. So the actual heat of the clay would then bind these together into not just single nucleotides, but now a nucleotide chain. Now, we can see this in this animation where we have this surface of clay, and we're going to have the single nucleotides coming in.
Researchers have shown that clays, such as montmorillonite, are able to catalyze the formation of polymers of RNA from single nucleotides. Nucleotides, shown in white and blue, adsorb to the surface of a small clay particle, shown in brown. As the surface becomes more crowded, nucleotides that are close together can undergo a chemical reaction, resulting in the formation of a polymer or strand of RNA.
So from the conditions of the early atmosphere with all the lightning, we get the spontaneous generation of all the monomers. And then along the clay crystals, there would be unbelievable numbers of strands of polymers of what we would now call abiotic RNA. They're abiotic because they're not alive, but they are recognizable as RNA. Now, somewhere out of all those countless trillions, huge numbers of abiotic RNA that have been formed by all the clay crystals over a very long period of time, there happens to be, by chance, one polymer that's capable of replicating itself. It finds complementary partners, now have two strands, and we're off. We start with RNA because it has a lot of very special properties. RNA can act as an enzyme that assists in its own replication and promoting protein synthesis. So here we have an RNA enzyme. It's a ribozyme. This is actually RNA, but it acts like an enzyme, so it can actually do stuff with other compounds. And so the RNA directly encodes for proteins that further assist in RNA replication. So it's possible that there was a time when the RNA did all the work that's now been assigned to the proteins, but the RNA then coded for these proteins to assist in its replication. Protein would be a good addition to the earliest strains of these self-replicating RNA because protein enzymes improve replication rates and accuracy. And then, of course, with the manufacture of structural proteins, these would provide shelter for those early RNA molecules.
This animation shows a mechanism by which RNA is replicated in a non-enzymatic manner. Single nucleotides find their complementary base on the template strand and undergo a chemical reaction to form a polymer. This reaction is possible because the nucleotides have been chemically activated so as to increase their reactivity. This animation shows the process of RNA replication being carried out by a theoretical RNA replicase ribosome. The replicase attaches to the end of the template strand. As the replicase moves along the template, it catalyzes the polymerization of a complementary strand. At a sufficiently high temperature, the individual strands of an RNA duplex will separate from each other. Upon cooling, the single-stranded RNAs may then undergo RNA folding. For each duplex, only one strand will form a functional ribozyme replicase. This newly formed replicase can use its complementary strand as a template to create yet more replicases.
In the early stages of life, we focus on RNA because we now know that RNA is capable of self-replication. It can do an awful lot of things on its own, even to the point that it can produce specialized RNA molecules that further improve the efficiency of replication.